keynote lecture, Big Bang Cosmology and Divine Creation. This is a part of Catholic Students Week that we've had going on all week. We've had it at Ottawa U, Dominican University College, who's right here. We've had friends at St. Paul University, at Carleton University, at Algonquin College, and La Cité Collégiale. So this year, all six campuses in Ottawa came together to celebrate faith, to live faith, to learn about faith, and to learn how to integrate it into our daily lives and our studies. So welcome one and all. My name is Laura Hughes. I am a campus minister here on campus. I work at St. Richard Parish on the corner. I'm so happy to see all your beautiful faces tonight, and especially to welcome our guest of honor, who I have been dying to see for about 6 months now. And without further ado, I'm actually going to introduce him. His name is Brother Guy Consolmagno. He is a Jesuit brother, born in Detroit. We love him anyway. I grew up in Windsor, I can say that. and he is a planetary scientist with the Vatican Observatory, recently named director of the Vatican Observatory. He specializes in meteorites and asteroids, and he'll tell you more about that because it's fascinating and far better than I can. He is a graduate of MIT, the University of Arizona, Harvard and MIT again. And he is one of the most fascinating speakers I have ever met. Even those of you here who are not science geeks will likely understand what he's talking about, which makes all of us non-science geeks pretty happy. So, welcome.
Thank you. It is wonderful to... I was going to say be home, so no, Ottawa is not the same as Detroit, but it's much closer than Arizona, which is where I live now. And someone was asking me how I like the weather. I love the winter when I have it for 3 days out of the year. And I'd also like to welcome His Excellency, the Archbishop. I'm not worried about there being an Archbishop in the audience, because after all, I am an observer from the Vatican. What I observe is stars and planets. And a lot of people wonder about the Vatican Observatory, so before I go into the talk itself, I want to show a little 5-minute film. I apologize, the translator doesn't have a script for this, but he can make things up. Both science and religion are conversations about the universe. They're ways of learning how we interact with this universe. It's not simply a question of, is there a God, but there is a God, now what do we do? It's not just a question of, there are a bunch of stars, but rather, why are there stars? How do they work? How does that tell us how things work here on Earth? The interaction that I see in my own life is that religion gives me the reason to do the science.
Back in the papacy before Francis was Benedict, and one of his lines in a final elocution to the fathers of the general congregation was, go to the frontiers. Well, there isn't much more frontier than 3.7 billion years away.
The first official interest of the church for astronomy started in 1582 with the reform of the calendar. Then in 1891, Pope Leo XIII wanted to have an observatory to show that the church is not against science, but the church promotes good science.
They start up by having telescopes on the Tower of the Winds, and then on the walls surrounding the Vatican, as the city lights grow, and as the Italian government gives them back the territory up in Castelgandolfo, in the 30s they build new telescopes on the roof of the Papal Palace in Castelgandolfo, best telescopes of their era in the 1930s. By the 1980s, light pollution makes those telescopes unusable, so we build a new telescope in the dark skies of Arizona.
Thank you. Alors, Father Jean-Baptiste Kikwaya et Luo. I'm working in three projects. The first one is NEOS, Near Earth Object. So what I'm doing with the NEOS is just observe them using our modern telescope VAT. The second project is METEORS. I worked on very faint METEORS, what we call shooting stars. And the third project is a set fireball network. They will have four cameras here around Tucson so that actually we can monitor any fireball getting into the Earth atmosphere in the region.
This telescope, the Vatican Advanced Technology Telescope, it was the first of the new technology telescopes that has been considered pretty much the norm now in developing telescopes. With the advance of computer technology, we have the capability of bringing that advanced technology directly into our telescope. So it's an expandable, it's almost like it's a living machine, so it can grow as technology grows.
It is still very important to maintain scientific research at the Vatican, simply because there is still a lot of confusion about this relationship between science and faith. We are not out here trying to prove the existence of God by looking through a telescope. That's not what we're doing. But we can say that if we want to obtain any reasonable results looking through that telescope, we need to do it embracing a certain work ethics that is, in fact, the same work ethics that the Bible itself tells us through commandments and through the Gospels to embrace.
Human beings look at the stars and wonder. They want to know, what is that? What is that about? How do I fit in? They hear about the moon landing and they want to know, what was that like? If we're part of the human race, we're part of the race that went to the moon. We're part of the species that looked at the stars and wondered, what the heck are those things? Looking at the sky reminds you that there's more to the universe than what's for lunch. What's more, if you believe in a universe that God so loved that he sent his son, then not only are you going to want to study the universe because it's kind of cool, it's an act of worship. It's an act of getting closer to the Creator and getting closer to a universe, as St. Athanasius said 1500 years ago, was cleansed and quickened by the Incarnation. Then, doing science is an act of worship.
Thank you. I also want to dedicate this talk to a Jesuit who died 2 years ago, Father Bill Stager, who was a cosmologist who did the mathematics of the Big Bang and a theologian and also gave retreats for nuns. How somebody could do all three of those things, I don't know. But I especially miss him because I've stolen all of my good ideas from him, including these articles on his Big Bang Cosmology and Conflict with Divine Creation, and a book that he helped edit, which is at a much more scholarly level on the same topic, Creation and the God of Abraham, which was out by Cambridge University Press. The inspiration for this talk comes from an article that appeared in the newspapers about 6 years ago in connection with a book entitled, I just realized my notes that I was going to be stealing from here, I don't have them in front of me. Should I fiddle this and get the notes? I'll just wing it. Stephen Hawking published a book with Leonard Vlamov called, it's not Brief History of Time, it's more the Grand Design, thank you. You see, if I had my notes, I would remember that. And in it, he says something to the effect of, we understand now how the universe began. The universe began with a fluctuation of the quantum gravity field. And therefore, we don't need God We don't need God to touch the blue, to light up the blue touch paper and start off the universe. That is the reason why there is something instead of nothing. I want to contrast that with, of course, the medieval view of the universe we see here, by first reminding you that that's not the medieval view of the universe. That's a 19th century view of the medieval view of the universe. And like many things out of the 19th century, they got it wrong. If nothing else, the people in the medieval time knew the world was round, not flat. They knew that the sun and the stars were not in the same sky. Likewise, the misconception of this illustration is a misconception that Stephen Hawking has, that a lot of the so-called new atheists, who are not so new and frankly not really atheists, so they don't know it. But if he is allowed to make this outrageous statement that we don't need God to start off the Big Bang, I'm going to stand here as a Jesuit brother at the Vatican Observatory and tell you something equally outrageous. He's right. We don't need God to start off the Big Bang. And the Big Bang and creation out of nothing is not what he's talking about. What he's talking about, of course, is based on Einstein's theory of general relativity. And a little bit of history here. Isaac Newton had worked out the theory of how physics ought to work. Einstein changed our common sense first in 1905 by showing that space and time were two aspects of the same reality, and that depending on what your point of view was, what your observing platform was, if it was moving or if it was standing still relative to the object you're observing, what is space in one frame of reference could be time in a different frame of reference. And therefore, you need to talk about space-time as a unified whole. If that wasn't strange enough, special relativity was just the special case if your observing platform has no forces or accelerations. In 1915, exactly 100 years ago, last November, he came up with general relativity, where he describes his idea of what gravity itself is. Gravity, according to him, is a warping of space and time. Now, it's hard to think in our heads how a three-dimensional entity like space-time could be warped. So let's make life simple and imagine the universe is two dimensions, a flat plane. And if you're an ant, you walk along the plane and you walk along the plane and you keep walking in a straight line. But now I add a mass which bends and warps the plane like a heavy weight in a rubber sheet. And the ant that gets too close to that thing still thinks it's walking in a straight line, but because the space has curved around the object, the ant goes in a curve around the object. In that way, planets like Venus orbiting the sun are curved and belt around. There were a couple of possible proofs of general relativity. The first strong indication that he might have something was that his theory could explain why the orbit of Mercury was slightly different from what Newton had predicted. The second, the one that made him famous, was the prediction that when starlight goes past something like our sun, it should get bent a little bit. Well, how can you see starlight going past the sun? The sun's in the way. You wait for an eclipse. And in 1919, Arthur Eddington observed eclipses and saw the starlight being bent. A third and more wild idea was that if you've got this rubber plane that can be warped and bent, if the weight that's doing the bending is actually moving, you can imagine setting up waves in this universe. The idea that the gravitational force could be propagated by a wave was finally proved in an announcement this morning. All of this indicating that Einstein had an idea what he was talking about. The thing about Einstein's theory, of course, is that it is far beyond our ability to imagine, and certainly far beyond the experience we have. If you walk outside this auditorium today and look at the universe, you're going to see a flat plane with a dome. You go out, and if you can see the stars would look like a dome. I don't care how many PhDs you've got, it looks like a dome. And water comes out of the sky, sometimes frozen water, so there must be water above the dome. But if you dig a hole, there's water below the dome. This is not silliness, this is observation. And the people who wrote Genesis were using the best physics of their day, Babylonian observations, to say, we all know this is what the universe looks like. The new thing in Genesis was, it is God who created it. It is God who caused it to be. That was the new radical idea out of Genesis. Not that the world was flat. They didn't need to read the Bible to see the world was flat. Anybody could see that for themselves. By the time of the ancient Greeks, it was obvious that a flat earth didn't work. Number one, as you move to the north or the south, you could see the stars shifting their position as if you were walking along the surface of a sphere. And secondly, you know that the moon is shining from reflected sunlight. You can see where the sun is, you can see where the moon is. You can work that out very easily with the naked eye. And there are times when the moon is exactly full and it moves into the shadow of the earth. And you can see the shape of the earth in the shadow it makes on the moon. You can see that it's round. And the ancient Greeks were even able, the famous work of Eratosthenes, that you could measure the size of the earth, and they got it right. They knew that the world was round, and they knew how big it was. The big mystery was, those stars out in the sky that appear now to be in a globe, not just a dome, in among them were a few other odd stars that moved in very, very peculiar ways. They didn't stick with the stars. They didn't keep moving in the same direction the way the moon did. Sometimes they'd go forward, sometimes they'd go backwards. Eudoxus comes up with an idea that Mars, one of those bright stars, is in a sphere that's rotating around the Earth, but that sphere is embedded in another sphere that's rotating at a slightly different rate, that's embedded in another sphere that's rotating at a slightly different rate, and that might be in a sphere that, and each of these spheres moving back and forth could account for, if you had enough spheres, the motion of Mars or the motion of any other planet. Now, you're living in a time when we're still developing ideas of physics. And you know from your experience here on Earth that there are things like that glove that are just sitting on the chair, and they're going to stay sitting on the chair, and the only time they move on the chair besides somebody moving them is if they fall down, or if you, you know, fill them with helium or set them on fire, they might go flying up. Things tend to move down or go up by their natural forces, but if they move back or forth, it's because something alive is moving them. So there must be living spirits moving each of those spheres. And they communicate with one another by sending little messenger spirits back and forth, sometimes called demons. Anybody who does Unix recognizes we use that term now for bits of a program that talk to each other. Sometimes they are called geniuses. And every sphere, it was decided, probably carried a different genius. So that if you were born at a time when the genius of sleep was trying to communicate to the sphere below, and you got a little bit of that genius, then you were a magician when it came to sleep. You could outsleep anybody. Maybe you'd have a more useless thing like the ability to play music. Who knows? That was the origin of that sense of astrology. This is about 500 BC. You move to about 150 AD, and a Greek working in the Roman Empire in Egypt comes up with a more clever mathematical way of calculating the positions of planets by saying that there are circles within circles within circles and circles within circles within circles. The fellow was named Ptolemy. And with these sets of circles, he was able to calculate and predict the positions of the planets. Why would you do this? Well, you watch pollsters, right? You listen to experts who are going to predict the stock market. Anybody who can predict the future can make you money. And we all know that these geniuses came from the planets. By knowing how the planets were moving, you could tell what genius was going to be overhead, and you could predict who was going to be the next emperor, who, you know, what's going to happen in the market. All he wanted to do was to calculate accurately where the planets could be. Now, this picture is completely different from the picture of the spheres, and both of those pictures are totally different from the picture that you find in Genesis. What's more, you've got the natural places of earth, air, water, and fire, and on the earth, you notice that things that move, because they're alive, eventually slow down and die. Even the pyramids wear out. But the motions of the stars are eternal. So clearly there's a boundary from where the moon is and below, where things are falling apart, and above, where things are perfect. This is the Aristotelian view of the universe. Now, many people are taught this and says, well, look, the Earth was at the center of the universe. Everybody thought the Earth was the most important place. What's at the center of the Earth? The inferno. Hell. Full of fire and brimstone. You don't believe there's fire and brimstone there? I can take you to the island of Volcano and show you the hole in the Earth where the fire and brimstone is coming out. None of this was foolishness. All of this was observation. But remember that if hell is the center of the center of the universe is no exalted place. If everything below the sphere of the moon falls apart and dies, it's not an exalted place. The Earth is not the center of the universe. The Earth is the bottom of the universe. The bottom of the chain of creation, just one level above the inferno itself. Now, curious thing. We've got the epicycles view of the universe, we've got the spheres view of the universe, and we've got the biblical view of the universe. There is a huge difference between the universe described in Genesis and the universe that was known even by the year 500 BC. And certainly by the time of Ptolemy in 150 AD. But there is no Galileo crisis in anybody's religion at that time, because people understood Scripture to be a book about God, not a book about nature. They understood Scripture a whole lot better than our modern fundamentalists. There were some people who challenged this. And St. Augustine, writing in a book on the literal interpretation of Genesis, his idea of literal is real different from our idea of literal. In this book, and again, if I had my notes here, I'd be able to read the exact quote, he says, now, every educated person understands how the planets move, how the Earth moves, how you predict eclipses, and they know this from reason, and they know this from observation, and we're sure we know what we're talking about. It is a scandal if a non-church layperson, an infidel, hears someone who's a Christian trying to explain Scripture and talking nonsense about the motions of the planets. Because it will discredit Scripture, and it will make people not listen to the moral lessons that you find in it. Interesting, remember, the science that people know from knowledge and experiences, the Ptolemaic world that we now know is totally wrong. the way, in fact, that the people of the Middle Ages reconciled the metaphysics of their time with the physics of their time was to say, all those motions of all those spheres, those weren't demons moving things, those were angels. There are seven planets that we have to explain. Mercury, Venus, the Moon, the Sun, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn. And there are, conveniently enough, seven ranks of angels. Now we know where they live. Not only that, but there were seven planets. That's one reason why we have 7 days in the week. And we name the days of the week for the planets. Those of you who speak French immediately know what I mean. Even those of you who speak English are familiar with Saturn Day and Sun Day and Moon Day. And the other days of the week are the German versions of Lunedì, Martedì, Mercoledì, which is the Italian. Incidentally, the numbering of the days of the week is older than recorded history. Today's Thursday, 7 days ago was Thursday, 7 days before that was Thursday, and it has been Thursday for 7 days back, longer than we have recorded time. Because we have these seven planets, including the Sun and Moon. There were other ideas about how the planets could be arranged. Copernicus had this strange idea that maybe you could do the calculations easier if the Sun was the center. And not only that, Copernicus actually suggested maybe the Sun really was the center, but he couldn't get the physics to work. In particular, he could not explain why, if the Earth is moving, you don't see the stars attend to shiggle their positions. So Tycho Brahe, around 1600, came up with a marvelous idea. The Earth is standing still, the stars are going around the Earth, the Sun goes around the Earth, but all the other planets go around the Sun. This can explain every observation that was available in the 16th and 17th century, including the incredibly close observations that Brahe himself made. It's also important to remember that the Copernican system was not that much of an improvement on the Ptolemaic system. He still assumed the planets moved in perfect circles, and he still had to have little circles and epicircles, and he even had the Sun moving in a tiny motion around the center. He needed all of these factors to be able to reproduce the observed positions of planets. Johannes Kepler had a different idea. He still was wedded with the thought that the nature of the physical universe reflected the nature of the metaphysical universe. And if he can't have the different planets being moved by the different ranks of angels, he could accept the Copernican view that the Sun was the center, but make an adjustment. And he writes in a letter to a friend of his that we've got, the Sun, S-U-N, because it is the biggest and brightest and most important thing in the sky, must be God the Father. The light coming off of the Sun is the Holy Spirit, pouring on the sphere where the Earth lies. Now, the trouble with the Copernican system was that the Sun was doing this funny little dance. God the Father is going to be really at the center and not moving. Can I come up with a system that allows God to stand still? And he realized that if he plotted the positions of planets not in perfect circles, but in ellipses, then the same point would be the focus of every ellipse of every planet's orbits, and it wouldn't have to move, which is exactly what he was looking for. He came to the idea of elliptical orbits, which we all know is true, on the basis of his totally wacky theology that God was somehow the Sun. He also writes in his book, and of course we all know you couldn't possibly come to a true conclusion if you begin with a false premise. So much for that. This revolution in our ideas was more than just a revolution of where the planets were and how they moved, because the idea of a universe with a set order and a set ranking of who goes where and how things were tied into the astrology of the day, tied into our understanding of our own place in the universe, at the bottom of the universe, sinful man, is described by C.S. Lewis in his book, The Discarded Image, as The Discarded Image. C.S. Lewis, you're familiar with him as the guy who read the Narnia books. He had a day job. And his day job was teaching Renaissance and medieval literature. And if you get this book, you can get a beautiful description of the medieval universe at a level so that you can read and understand Dante and Chaucer and know what they're talking about. This idea of ranks of angels, this idea of spirits that inhabited not just, you know, one for each planet, but all of the inner and intermediary spheres as well. This was the foundation of the way the human race understood itself that had lasted 1,500 years. And Lewis himself states that there are few constructions of the imagination that seem to me to have combined splendor, sobriety, and coherence in the same possible degree. Now, it's possible some of you readers may have been itching to remind me that it did have a serious defect. It was not true, but it sure was beautiful. You can understand why people were reluctant to let go of this foundation of our civilization, this foundation of how we and the medievals before us, and the Romans before them, and the Greeks before them, and even the Arabs, and even the people that lived on the other side of Europe, everybody understood this is how the universe worked. There were several major reasons why the Copernican system did not triumph for a long time after it was proposed. Copernicus publishes his book on his deathbed in 1542. Galileo, with his telescope, shows that you can see the planets moving in the way that Copernicus predicted, but it's not proof that Copernicus was right. And that wasn't until 80 years after Copernicus. Galileo dies in 1638, which is the year that Isaac Newton is born. There are two major reasons why most scientists, even after Galileo, did not accept the idea of the sun being at the center of the universe. I mentioned one of them, the fact that if the Earth is moving, you can look at me and look at the person in front of you and move your head back and forth. Okay? You notice that the motion of the person's head in front of you, of course, if they're moving at the same time you are, then that our relative position appears to shift as your head is shifting. Maybe it's better to say, look at the podium, look at me, and shift your head back and forth. And you can see how the position of the microphone compared to me has changed. If the Earth is moving, stars that are closer should appear to move compared to stars that are farther back. Do we think that stars are closer and farther back? When you look at a star through a telescope, you can see that nearby bright stars are much bigger in the telescope. They make a nice big disk. And faint stars, which must be farther away because they're fainter, make a much smaller disk. And you can measure the size of the disk in your telescope and compare that to the size of the sun. And if you're going to say that that star is the same thing as our sun, you can say, well, it must only be about 10,000 times farther away than the sun is. I would say call 10,000 AU. And if stars were that close, we would see them move. And we don't see them move. The trouble was they did not understand optics. The disk of light you see in a telescope is not the size of the star. It's a measure of the lack of precision of the optics of your telescope, which is a function of the wave nature of light. So even if you had perfect lenses, you would always still see a disk. And the bigger the lens, the bigger the aperture, the smaller the disk, in a way that was only understood in the 19th century. They didn't know that. The other problem, though, was that we had 1,500 years of Aristotelian physics that explained everything that we could see, and it doesn't explain how you could have the sun and the earth moving around the sun. It was only Newton. Many years later, a generation after Galileo, in the 1680s, finally, you know, his final book in the 1730s, finally explaining what how gravity, the same gravity that causes an apple to fall, can also explain the motion of the earth, moon around the earth, or the motion of the earth around a star. But by explaining, I must be careful, what Newton can do is calculate how fast the gravity is going to cause the apple to fall, how far the moon is going to be from the earth given its speed. He can calculate the motions of things due to gravity. Oh, wait a minute. You're telling me that everything has gravity. So I've got gravity, and you've got gravity, and I can calculate that the force is incredibly tiny. But why should there be any force at all? We're not touching each other. How can I possibly be communicating that there's a force between me and him? How does the sun tell Mars that it's there? How does gravity work? And the challenges to Newton continually asked him, explain what is this action at a distance? What is this gravity? And Newton had the perfect answer. He says, oh no. He said it much more elegantly. He said, I feign no hypotheses. All I'm going to do is to tell you how it works. Let somebody else figure out why it works. What Newton also did, besides, you know, growing trees based on apples falling, was to work out the larger set of physics that now explained why planets moved in ellipses. His explanation of how things work explained this beautifully, and he explained it in a set of laws that says that an object at motion stays at motion, an object if at rest stays at rest, an object moving will be in a straight line, unless you act on it with a force. What's a force? Well, it's mass times acceleration. What's acceleration? The change of speed with time. Well, what's speed? It's change of position with time. Well, what is position? And what is time? And what is mass? Oh, I feign no hypotheses. But this idea of a universe that said, if you tell me the exact position of every point in the universe, and you tell me the mass of every point in the universe, and you tell me the forces that are acting on each of those masses, I can calculate perfectly every place they've been in the past, every place they're going to be in the future, because the universe is one giant machine. And that's the point of view of Newton. Where do you need God? Well, somebody had to build the machine, somebody had to wind the watch. So God becomes the great clockmaker and the great clock winder. Newton said something else, actually, though. He said, you know, I can explain why planets go around the sun, because they have mass and the sun has mass, but Jupiter has mass and Saturn has mass, and how come they don't pull each other out of their orbits? I could try to calculate whether they're going to do that or not, but I don't quite have the math. He had only just invented calculus. I can't figure out why the planets should be stable. This must be where God is acting. I need God in order to explain the stability of planetary orbits. And a lot of theologians go, aha! We now have a scientific proof of the existence of God. because we need God to explain the motions of the planets, and we need God in order to explain the origin of the watch. Well, Laplace, 100 years after Newton, has a lot better mathematical tools, works out the perturbations of the planets, proves that they're negligible, comes up with a wonderful book on the orbit of planets, and says, and presents it to the Emperor Napoleon, and Napoleon, looking through it, says, I don't see God anywhere in this. And Laplace very cleverly says, I have no need of that hypothesis. Sounds like Stephen Hawking. But notice, the God that he has no need of is a God who's the watchmaker God, and the God who fits in the gaps of what we don't understand, and the God who has been reduced to just one force acting alongside gravity. Hardly the God of Scripture. Laplace was right. We don't need that kind of God. Incidentally, Laplace was wrong in this sense. We now actually have measured and calculated what's going on in the early solar system, where we've got a lot of small bodies that are all thinking of becoming a planet, and a bunch of larger bodies. So we've got the Sun there, the red thing is Jupiter, the yellow thing is Saturn, the blue thing is Neptune, the orange thing is Uranus. And as time goes on, Jupiter and Saturn, Jupiter is slowly throwing things out of the solar system, which causes its orbit to shrink, so it gets into a resonance where it can suddenly perturb Saturn, and Saturn then perturbs Uranus and Neptune, and the planetary orbits are wildly unstable for a while. Chaos actually does happen. Why do we know that? Because every other solar system we've seen, there's about 2,000 of them now, have the giant planets all mixed up in a way that even our solar system isn't mixed. The God of the mechanistic universe, the God of the deists, they call themselves, the God of the 18th century, the God that George Washington and Thomas Jefferson thought they believed in, the mechanical God, is a God who is very different from a God of love, a personal God, a God who was himself incarnate. And yet we're faced with the fact that Newton still had a really successful view of the universe and how it worked. There's basically the common sense view that the non-students of physics, how many people in this room have not taken university physics? Yeah, all of you ignorant people out there. You believe in basically the same physics, the same common sense physics as Aristotle. And you probably know the answer to this one, but you shouldn't be surprised if a lot of people seeing this coiled hose with the tap, you show this to people and you say, what's going to happen when I turn on the tap? The water's going to go around and around and around and around and around. And when it comes out the end of the hose, what direction is it going to go in? And many people will say, well, it's been trained into going around and around and around, so it'll keep going around and around and around. Now, those of you who have taken Newtonian physics, you know the answer. Once it's no longer under the force of the hose, how does it travel? In a straight line out the hose. And that's the answer in the back of your book. Well, it's not so cold outside. Coil up a hose like that. Attach it to a faucet. Stand next to it and turn on the water. I dare you! Because you know, when you think about it, what's really going to happen, the hose is going to go flying all over the place. Because the Newtonian view is a little oversimplified. And you can say, well, okay, if I've calculated all the forces and all the bits of hose as the water's going through, maybe that would be as complicated as the Ptolemaic calculation of every epicycle inside of every epicycle. If I had an infinite number of epicycles, I can describe the motions of the planets just as well as Newton could. But I would do it in a way that did not lead to the insight of how physics works. If I'm trying to animate in a cartoon how the hose is going to work, I could calculate But the calculation would be useless calculation. All we know is it's going to go flying around in a way that's more complicated than we can calculate. We forget that the universe is more complicated than Newtonian physics. Still, Newtonian physics ultimately, I suppose, is capable of describing everything we see, right? Well, it's not capable of describing this. The bright things there are clusters of galaxies, and the circles of light are because behind that cluster of galaxies, what's a galaxy? 1 billion to 100 billion stars into a lump, and then there's a dozen such lumps, and then behind it is another galaxy whose light would be going off in that direction, but it gets bent around the cluster of the galaxy because things with mass warp space and time. And we can see in images like this, what's called gravitational lensing, Einstein arcs. And Newton's physics can't explain that. And Newton's physics can't explain the gravity waves. And Newton's physics can't explain the thing that Einstein could explain. But Einstein is saying that a lot of the things we assumed with Newton aren't true.